Hello everyone, I want to talk about source verification. First thing, the motivation, like why do we need to do that? Like life is hard enough in this times of COVID and stuff. So why now this whole source verification thing? It adds important context to make a signing decision. The thing is currently what we often see is basically YOLO signing, because what you see here is basically not meant for humans, that's meant for machines, but often we just have to deal with that because currently there's not a lot of options to avoid that. But bytecode metadata is already a feature of Solidity since 0.4.7, which is like ages ago, 2016, released at that point. And it's basically CBOR encoded metadata hash and a Solidity compiler version. What we are most interested in is the metadata hash. The problem with that is that existed for a long time, but often it was not accessible. Basically, it's either an IPFS URL or a Swarm URL. Swarm URL is in the beginning, now there's also IPFS. But the problem is people didn't really publish it or had the option to pin it, basically. So things were lost. So when I wanted to access it from a wallet, for example, I couldn't resolve that anymore. That's basically what we want to fix. So how can we publish metadata? One wonderful thing now is that Remix added this wonderful publish to IPFS when you did deploy. And I just want to do that in between. And I want to do that we later see it's like fresh data. I take a random word from the internet and hope that it's nothing bad. That seems to be okay. We don't get censored by YouTube, so I add it here. I compile this contract, compile it, and deploy it, and publish to IPFS. Okay. MetaMask, confirm, everything's wonderful. And now we want to see basically what happens under the hood when we do that. So that was the simple life we had before, basically. We had a deployer, that's often like you, and we have this blockchain, that's where we deploy to. And now things get a bit more complex, but with most of the complexity, you don't have to deal, basically, that's what we deal with. Basically now, the deployer doesn't only deploy to the blockchain, but also publishes to Swarm or IPFS. And if that is done, the monitor is picking it up. Basically, a monitor monitors if there's new contract creations on the chains, then gets the data, if it's available, from Swarm or IPFS, verifies it, index it, and pins it. That is important, basically, that solves the availability problem that we had before. And then there is one more thing. It's basically a manual input for the verifier that's mainly for old contracts, basically, for historical ones, that you can do them. And that's looking like that. Basically, you find that currently on verification.computing.org and can verify it there. You have to specify the network and specify the address, drag the files in there, and you're done. Or even easier now, also with the Remix plugin, basically there's now the source verify plugin. And then in the source verify, basically you see also specified network, and then the files are already selected. So it's a bit easier. And then you can also publish that. But you don't need to do that usually because when you just click deploy to IPFS, that's already done. So how can we now access this metadata? One thing is you can access it via IPNS. We publish it via IPNS. The problem with that is IPNS is currently very slow. There's a bug open for that for a long time. Happily, like with Go IPFS, which was just released this week, resolving IPFS records should simply get faster. I tried it out, it's not yet, but the IPFS maintainers say more people need to migrate to IPFS 050 to have that change basically take effect. And their tests that they did, basically that they are also in the real world. So all of you who run IPFS nodes, please update, then that gets faster. Another version is basically to access it via ENS. The only problem with that is basically it's slower in updating because you have to pay transaction fees to do that, but resolution is much faster and we can get more decentralization that way. Because with IPNS, basically you just have one key, with ENS you can have multiple keys. And you can also access it via normal HTTPS, but we want to have it decentralized, so that's basically the fallback option. So how can we use this metadata? First of all, now there is a warning, like in Wolf, I do a warning if there is no metadata to force people to do that, and I hope other wallets also do that in the future. So that's basically the negative thing. But the positive thing is, if we do that, we can use, for example, NutSpec. For example, here you see now votes for proposal 23 with a score of 5. And I want to show that basically with the contract we deployed before. And here you see that it's confirmed on Etherscan and the metadata is deployed. So now our verification server should have picked it up. So I have to copy basically the URL and start the emulator. And then we make a transaction to this address. Did I copy it? And now we see we can add an action. Basically, we just have one function here. So we will just have one action. And we get this warning because we don't have a fallback function. Basically, we get the warning we cannot estimate the gas. So now we have this basically score and proposal. And let's say we give it a score of 8 because it's 8 o'clock. And 42 is always a good number. We do that. And now you see vote for proposal 42 with a score of 8. And the other cool thing you can then get is basically it's just enabled for developers. So you have in the settings to set the UI developer. You can also directly access the source code, which I find like I want to see more source code of the contracts I'm interacting with. Yeah. So that's basically that. Another cool thing that you then can do with the source verifier plugin basically is to load the contracts of an address into Remix directly and play with them. And also what is really cool, new feature that basically you can debug directly a transaction and it downloads the source code. I also want to show that. So basically this is the so transaction hash, and you have to use another profile for that, because otherwise it would be quite pointless. Another profile, let's see here. Okay, and then we have to select. Jan wants to fix that because then we can also do that basically from. Like inside Wolf directly debug from there, but currently that's not possible because we need a provider. That's why we need to basically switch to injected Web3 here. Then we can debug and then enter the transaction hash. Then it's downloading the sources here and recompiling, and you have the sources here. Wonderful. That's working fine. So the next thing basically we can do, basically that's more the run part of the presentation or what we need to really improve. Currently, like there exists NutSpec and there exists RutSpec. Both have spec in their name, but both are not really spec'd. Like there is no good specification. Like NutSpec basically says use JavaScript, but really lacks also for the information, for example, like how to access things in the contract with that. There's not much specification. And RutSpec only like is a JavaScript implementation currently, and there's a third-party documentation, but it's basically abandoned. And I did collect some metrics basically about what is currently used from NutSpec and RutSpec. You can find that on contract metrics at computing. The good thing is because it's not much used currently, people also like don't use all the features. And I think, and that might be a thing we could discuss in the session also afterwards, if Nick wants, perhaps that could also then be part the specification that we basically make a simple specification first and then extend it. And also because it could be nice that I have a part of the package manager to specify what is currently actually used, because I have to like guess if it is RutSpec or NutSpec. With RutSpec, I can see if certain keywords are used. I know that it's RutSpec, but it's currently a guessing game. It should be part of the metadata in the end, I think. But that could be part of EVPM. Nick will talk directly afterwards about it. It's a nice project, which basically standardizes metadata. And now that will come together with the source verification and be a standard together. There are some open tasks still to do. What is quite important is basically that we add the whole thing, not only to Remix as the IDE, but also basically to all the CI pipelines, that the publishing is done automatically or automagically. So basically in Truffle, please do the plugins. That would be really nice. Basically, that should be all automatic. Dapp node integration would be really nice. And get more wallets to support it. And I hope also more wallets then do basically this warning and warn their users. And I think it's their duty to warn the users that they interact with an unverified contract, because that is fucking dangerous. And we need to decentralize more aspects. We tried to decentralize a little bit more. Before there was Etherscan, I think we went a step further than Etherscan now, but there's still a little bit of work to do. We're currently, a little bit of centralization is still left, and we need to get rid of that. We have ideas for that, but we need to go step by step. That's the thing. How you could really help, it's basically, for example, if you have a dApp node, install this IPFS pinner, and PIN verificated, that basically we solve this availability problem, that when we go down, that we are not the only ones pinning this content. Please pin this content, like for example with the IPFS pinner or with your own scripts, that would also work. Then what we really should do with the ENS thing, currently we do basically call content hash directly on the resolver. But it would be much nicer if we generate a DAO basically, that just we propose the new content, and then have some strategy, like some people in an organization that need to propose it and agree on the new content, and they all verify, that's important, basically that they all verify the content, recompile the contracts and see that it's valid, and then publish it to ENS, that the trust is less. Because currently we could publish badly verified contracts, but then you could see it in the end, but not on all, for example, mobile wallets. You don't want to recompile all of them. There are also some open challenges that not only tasks is a bit more harder. Basically, branding and awareness, we need to raise more awareness for that. And also, like currently, we just call it verification.computing, but that's more like there was no name in between. If you have a nice name or have branding ideas, that would be really nice. Hardware, we have a logo now, that's really good, since last week, logo, very, very good. Hardware wallet support would be really nice, but it's challenging because there's the air gap between the hardware wallet. There are some ideas basically that you load and sign the content to the hardware wallet regularly. For example, the Tracer Model T has an SD card. There are ways, but that's a bit a harder thing. Localization is a big issue, and that basically also ties into mutability. Basically, the metadata you want to publish is immutable, but what we could do is basically links to where you could get your translations or where you could get updates, because like interfaces, sometimes you just want to update. It's complex, and we need to find strategies to do that without losing the guarantees we create here. Credits, like who are basically we, like Christian Reifwiesner is the main driving force on that. Thanks for that. Christopher and Eddie, wonderful work. Mark also, and the Remix team, big up, because they integrated that already very fast and wonderfully to test that out. You could also join, like we have a source verify repo, join there and grab some issues, create some new ones, try it out, or close issues and submit pull requests. That's always, we are happy to see that. And join the conversation. Like we have this GitHub room, you know, now through the summit basically about the GitHub. Join us on GitHub. We are on Ethereum/sourceverify. We also like have a video conferencing each Monday. So perhaps ask us to also join that if you want to contribute something. And that's basically it for me. Do we have time for questions? Or 5 minutes, I think. Yeah.
Yes, thank you, Ligi. I would be very interested to learn more about the logo. I didn't know you have a logo yet.
I had to do all the screenshots newly, basically, because the logo just appeared there. It's this, Source Verify.
Ah, okay.
And I think as nasty as it sounds, but it's quite important basically that people know about that and that there is a little bit of branding and a little bit people are aware that we basically overcome this issue that nobody really cares for that currently. Because you basically need the stamp of this thing is verified. This, you know, that you basically get a bad feeling if you interact with a unverified contract and you really should.
Yeah, I like the term YOLO signing a lot.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
All right. So please, if you have any questions in the room, raise your hand now and use the raise your hand feature. Yeah, Mr. Chico.
I'm wondering if you have attempted to crawl EtherScan and get all of the sources from there.
Basically, for example, the contract matrix is doing that, but there comes this legal problem that Christian mentioned. It's not really like we could import it. It would be really easy. Like I have it locally here because I look up some things, but I don't just want to import it into that. That has basically two reasons. A, this legal thing, and B, EtherScan also injects things in the metadata, and then we cannot really recompile things. So basically, yeah, but also mainly the legal thing. I want to stay legal.
I tried recompiling stuff from EtherScan, but I failed for all the contracts. And the interesting thing is, so EtherScan says fully 100% match. Actually, I think the website says 100% match, but it's never a 100% match because they ignore the metadata hash. They never compare them with metadata hash. So, and the cool thing about the metadata hash is it's an hash anchor that that anchors the actual source that was used to compile the binary that was then deployed. And for EtherScan, you can add arbitrary comments, you can rename variables and so on, and will still say 100% match. This is not the case here.
Okay, we have a couple of more questions. Leo was next.
No, I just wanted to say that the logo looks like the Solidity and the Viper logos together.
Might be that this is the case. I don't know.
It might be, yeah.
But it's also SV, so it also fits. I don't know.
Then we have Richard.
I just wanted to ask, like the last time I checked, this metadata file also contained to some extent my like local pass, or like sometimes, actually it was not always consistent. Sometimes it was like a absolute pass, sometimes it was a relative pass, but this kind of made it for me impossible to verify the contract that I uploaded before from a computer that I reset it, like because I don't have the same pass anymore. I don't have the setup from the time anymore, but it actually requires me to, like, that's why for me to do it for contracts in the past is really hard. Like if I now upload a contract, I can do it now. This is not
so
tricky.
It's still possible. So, I mean, if you have the metadata file, then the paths are all there. You just need the metadata file and then, so the compiler doesn't care about the path of the file. The compiler just takes the path you send it and uses that. So it's always about how you call the compiler.
Yeah, but I need to have the metadata file to create the same hash again, right? Like if I don't know what was my, like I don't have the metadata file.
Exactly, that's the problem.
I have the exact source from this point, but I don't have the metadata file, which has some nuances that I cannot reproduce, and therefore I cannot get it to verify from the old version.
I know that's an issue. But I mean, this is not just about the paths, it's about any settings or whatever, right?
No, it's true. I think the path was for me the one that was the most obvious one, that you see the first something that happens there.
Yeah, that's why we really need to get it in all the CI pipelines, that you don't have to do it retrospectively. I think it's just important for really often used contracts that we might be able to verify them again. But ideally, it's automatically. Then it's even easier than with EtherScan. You don't have to check checkboxes. You just, you know, it's part of your pipeline. You just agree to somewhere. The only problem that, for example, Truffle had, they didn't know, didn't want to do it by default because some might not want to publish their source code. I don't know why.
So and big thumbs up to Truffle. They store the metadata file, but they also include the full path, which is kind of a little downside. But
okay, we have more questions. Next up is Alex.
It was more like a comment on when Chris said with the EtherScan, they have been removing the metadata for quite a bit. I think ever since it was introduced, because we also had like the experimental flag in it, and it was just causing confusion. But I've been recently, at least I verified one contract on Etherscan. I think after ECC, and I just grabbed the sources from the repo and verified it myself. It wasn't my contract. And realized just after doing it, I mean, I talked to the author, but I realized after just after doing it that I should have added a comment into the source, because it wouldn't have detected it. And I could have said, you know, anything I wanted there. And this wouldn't be the case if the metadata is considered. So it wouldn't be the case for source verify.
Okay, and another question from Lucas.
Okay, my question is, isn't having a verified source without the metadata better than having no verified source at all? So isn't there some value in this? Because at least I know that, yeah, this source code generates the exact same bytecode. So.
Sure, but I mean, the hope is that just publishing the metadata and storing it is just part of the deploy workflow.
No, I totally get that, but I see some value in making most of the legacy code.
We're actually also thinking about adding source code to this repository that does not match the metadata, but everything else. But then the problem is, what is the correct thing? What if someone else uploads another code that also compiles to the same bytecode? Do you store both of them, or just the first one, or what do you do, right?
Yeah, but at least one source code that compiles to the same bytecode is definitely helpful.
Yeah, sure.
Because all the old contracts are still interesting to look at, and having them in there, having them not in there just because we don't have the metadata doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah.
This is the exact problem Etherscan has, because whoever verifies it first is able to introduce comments as they wish. And then they do have the option to reach out to Etherscan, because it's an authority on this, to replace the code. But if you decide to only store the first one, then it's up to whoever does it first to make the source look like as they wish, as long as it compiles to the same binary.
Okay, there's one more comment from Cairo on Gitter, and then let's move on to the next session after that. Cairo says, the problem is I do not want the source code of a project in testing to become public while we do testing on e.g. Robston. The problem is I do not, once we go to mainnet, we may be fine with the source being public right away.
Yeah, don't be afraid to publish source code like that. It's the same problem on GitHub often. People are just too afraid to publish something. Like, just look at others, and it's no shame to publish that. Why not? Like, I don't see a reason why not. Like, publish it. Publish early, publish often. Because otherwise, often you have the problem. People say, yeah, we will publish it later. But then people can look at it later and tell you later that there's a problem. I don't think that's a problem. Publish as soon as the first line is there. But that's my personal opinion.